Without objection.
Mr. President, it seems a bit surreal, but necessary nonetheless, to come here to the Senate floor and talk about the perils of socialism and its sudden resurgence within the Democratic Party. We've seen our Democratic friends push for policies like Medicare for All, which would completely wreck the system that provides health care for our seniors and force all Americans onto the same plan, regardless of the fact they never paid anything into it like our seniors have, and regardless of the fact they may indeed like their private health insurance that they get from their employers. You remember when the Obama administration promised in 2013, if you like your plan, you can keep it. Well, I don't really think they meant it, but that's at least what they said. But Democrats have gotten so far more radical today. Their motto should be, if you like your plan, you can't keep it under Medicare for All. They've also promised things like free college, and believe me, free is popular, especially if you don't think you're ever going to have to end up paying for it, promising anyone and everyone that they can go to college for free. Now, there are some smart things we can do to help prepare high school students and college students to hold down their debt and to make sure that they get the sort of advice and counseling they need to make sure that they are studying something that is going to be able to provide them an income with which they can repay the loans that they take out. And there's some work we need to do in that area. Across Texas, I've had a chance recently to go to a number of middle schools and high schools. And in Texas, and I'm sure we're not alone, there are many high schools where students can get dual credit, college and high school credit, and many of them, or some of them at least, graduate from high school with essentially 2 years of college behind them, and it costs them nothing. It's free. I guess that's free. Actually, it's not free either, but they don't have to pay anything more for it, and their parents don't have to pay anything more for their property or sales tax for it. So that's a smarter way to approach this, rather than this radical idea that things that like college can be somehow free, knowing that actually there will be somebody that pays for it, whether it's our children when they grow up and they have to pay back the money that we have recklessly borrowed in our deficits and debt, or by raising taxes, which you can't raise taxes enough on the rich people in order to pay for this. So inevitably, that burden will fall on the middle class. But to put the icing on the cake on these radical policies, you have to look at this Green New Deal proposal that that Democrats have rolled out, and really call this the icing on the cake in their socialist proposals. They want to take over the entire energy sector of the economy, and they want to regulate it, and they want to tax it in such a way as to promise somehow something that is never going to be realized. For example, they say they want to achieve net zero emissions in 10 years. Well, Texas, Oklahoma, other states generate a lot of electricity from renewable sources, particularly wind-generated energy. But there's no way in the world you're going to be able to eliminate things like natural gas and other sources of energy, because the wind doesn't always blow and the sun doesn't always shine. And so you're going to need something to provide the base load when the wind is not blowing and the sun is not shining. So this idea, this pie in the sky idea of a net zero emissions in 10 years by going entirely to renewables is simply fantasy. They also want to overhaul our transportation system. They want to rebuild and retrofit every single building in the country. But they offer no real details, and in fact, I think there's a reason for that, because they don't even talk about the details of what needs to be accomplished or the cost there would be associated with trying to accomplish it. One, the only estimate that I've seen is a $93 trillion price tag, but that's an important piece of information that you would think the public would have a right to know. And that's not something the advocates of the Green New Deal have been particularly proud of. Even if this is something the majority of Americans wanted, we don't currently have the technology or the resources to make it happen. Our Democratic friends know that. So they're in essence making a promise for something that they can't deliver because of the price, because the technology has not yet been invented. And so what was really bizarre here on the Senate floor is when the majority leader provided our Democratic colleagues a chance to vote on this resolution on the Senate floor, not a single Democratic colleague voted for it. They voted present. Well, that's a new one on me. I thought when we came here to the Senate, our job was to represent our constituents and vote yes or no on legislation. So to show up and vote present seems to me like an abdication of that responsibility. But it also is some evidence of how really cynical and insincere this proposal really is. But that's not to say it isn't popular when you start offering free things and you start promising things that are unaffordable or unattainable. But instead of talking about these policies that are unwanted, unachievable, and unaffordable, let's talk about some real solutions. I think that's the responsibility of people like me who say the Green New Deal won't cut it, to which people might ask, well, what are your suggestions? And I think that's an important and fair question. No matter what your perspective on energy issues in the environment, I think every single one of us can agree on at least one point. We need smart energy policies that will strengthen our economy without bankrupting American families. I would just note parenthetically, Mr. President, that we've actually made some pretty good progress when it comes to emissions control. Since 2017, combined U.S. emissions of six criteria air pollutants have gone down 73%. That's as of 2017. It's gone down 73% since 1970. During that same period of time, the American economy grew by 262%. The number of vehicle miles traveled grew 189%, and our population grew 59%. So we were able to reduce pollutants 73% at a time when the population was growing, people were driving more, and our economy was growing. More recently, between 1990 and 2017, the U.S. reduced sulfur dioxide concentrations by 88%, lead by 80%, nitrogen dioxide by 50%, particulate matter by 40%, ground-level ozone by 22%, and carbon monoxide by 77%. Since from 2005 to 2017, carbon dioxide emissions declined nearly 15% in the United States. During that same period of time, and this is a fair comparison, China's annual carbon dioxide emissions have increased roughly double, twice what they were during the same time period. So I would say that we can blame America first for all sorts of problems. I don't think that's fair, nor is it accurate. And particularly when you start talking about the environment and controlling ozone-defeating CO2 emissions, I think there's a better way to approach it, and we need to start with the facts. And I think the facts are that we need to form partnerships to leverage the capabilities of the private sector and achieve cost-effective solutions. None of the people advocating the Green New Deal really can tell you how much will you be paying for electricity if we were able to implement the Green New Deal. How much would you have to pay for your transportation costs? How much would you have to pay to heat or to cool your house? We need policies that make sense, that are unaffordable, that are achievable, and that will actually bring down the cost of each of those items for the American people. So the solution isn't a $100 trillion Green New Deal. It's good old-fashioned, all-American innovation. By incentivizing research into the development of new technologies, we can keep costs low for taxpayers while securing our place as a global leader in energy innovation. One great example of the type of solution I'm suggesting you could learn about by taking a trip to the Net Power plant in La Porte, Texas, right outside of Houston, which I did recently. Net Power has developed a first-of-its-kind power system that generates affordable, zero-emissions electricity. Using their unique carbon capture technology, they've taken natural gas, one of the most prevalent and affordable energy sources that there is, and they've made it emission-free. This is a shining example of the environmentally and fiscally responsible policies that we should be advocating and supporting. Last year, renewables accounted for only 17% of our total energy sources. That includes hydropower, wind, solar, biomass, and various other sources, 17%. Natural gas already accounts for more than double that. So if we could take this incredibly common and affordable energy source and make it more environmentally friendly, why wouldn't we do that? Why wouldn't that be a more sensible, fiscally responsible way of addressing it? These policies are important for conservation, but also for securing our competitiveness on the world stage. If American companies don't produce these technologies first, well, you bet somebody else will. The heavy-handed government approaches we're seeing from our Democratic colleagues is not the answer. Instead, we've got to harness the power of the private sector and build partnerships to drive real solutions. Yes, we need to invest in innovative solutions and encourage the private sector to continue prioritizing reliable, affordable, and environmentally sound energy sources. When you implement government policies that get government out of the way and let the experts do their jobs, you can be pro-energy, pro-innovation, pro-growth, and pro-environment. I'll soon be introducing some legislation that I think will help us move down that road. We know the U.S. leads the world in emissions reduction, and this bill will build on that success without a one-size-fits-all mandate that would bankrupt our country. Mr. President, on another topic, as I highlighted earlier this week, the Senate has unanimously passed the Debbie Smith Act of 2019, which would provide critical resources for law enforcement to test rape kits, prosecute criminals, and deliver justice for victims. This was a major bipartisan achievement, and I look forward to working with our House colleagues to get this legislation to the President's desk as soon as possible. But there's more we need to do to assist victims of violence and sexual assault. For example, today I'm filing the Help End Abusive Living Situation, or HEALS Act, that will provide domestic violence survivors with expanded access to transitional housing. This will help these victims permanently leave their abusers, rebuild their lives, and begin a long-term healing process. But even more pressing, folks on both sides of the aisle agree that we need to reauthorize and strengthen the Violence Against Women Act, also known as VAWA. It's something I strongly support, and an issue my friend, our friend, and colleague Senator Ernst continues to champion here in the Senate. Now, Republicans and Democrats say we must do more to provide services for victims of domestic violence and sexual assault. And while we've certainly had some disagreements on the way to do that, there's no question that VAWA has traditionally been a bipartisan commitment. That's why I was so shocked, earlier this year when House Democrats blocked a Republican effort to reauthorize this critical law before it lapsed last February. The current Violence Against Women law lapsed in February because House Democrats refused to allow us to extend it. Now, why would they do that? If they claim to be supportive of efforts to protect women and others from violence and assault, why would they let the very law that authorizes the various programs that Congress has paid for in the past, why would they let that lapse? Well, sadly, this is where politics rears its ugly head. We were seeking a short-term reauthorization of the existing Violence Against Women Act so bipartisan negotiations could continue on a long-term update and extension of the law. But House Democrats recklessly blocked this reauthorization of VAWA because they were seeking to add controversial provisions that should never be part of a consensus bill, certainly not one that enjoys broad bipartisan support. In the face of this political jockeying by House Democrats, I'm proud to say that the Appropriations Committee did the right thing and continued to fully fund all Violence Against Women Act programs through the remainder of this fiscal year. So this means that House Democrats, when they tried to kill VAWA by refusing to reauthorize it, actually failed to accomplish their goal. If their goal was to deny women and other victims of violence the critical funding needed for these programs. So despite the efforts they undertook to let VAWA expire, critical domestic violence and sexual assault prevention programs will continue to receive full federal funding until we can reach a bipartisan consensus agreement and update the law. So good for the Appropriations Committee for making that happen. But my point is, Mr. President, that VAWA should never be used as a political plaything or pawn. I'm somewhat encouraged by ongoing bipartisan negotiations here in the Senate, and I commend Senator Ernst for her commitment to this effort and look forward to supporting a long-term extension of VAWA that is done in the right way, through negotiation and agreement, not political gamesmanship. That's the wrong way to do things. We know better if people will simply stop the political posturing and political games and do the work the American people sent us here to do. Mr. President, I yield the floor, and I note the absence of a quorum.
Clerk will call the roll.